Since prehistoric times, the arrow, propelled by the bow, has been the weapon most universally used by Aboriginal people in America. The spear ranked second in importance. For hunting and for war, the Indians fitted both arrow shaft and spear with points made from brittle stone, flint, chert, and obsidian or volcanic glass. Although the Indians of California used all of these materials, they preferred and made greatest use of obsidian. It is found at several places in the mountains of California. The Indians made long journeys to obtain this material directly from these natural sources. Some groups fasted during their journey, since the act of obtaining obsidian was often regarded as a semi-religious undertaking. The remains of Indian workshops are found around some of these quarries of volcanic glass. The great quantities of flake material indicate that many of the Indians roughed out blanks on the spot. This was done so that waste material could be immediately discarded and not transported long distances. Some tribes, among them the Talua of northwestern California, secured obsidian in the form of water-washed pebbles taken from the stream beds. They chose fist-sized pebbles because they were relatively easy to transport and work. Obsidian varies in color from jet black to mottled red, and it is sometimes almost transparent, depending upon its source. As the name implies, volcanic glass is a brittle glass-like rock. Because it has a conchoidal fracture and is particularly amenable to controlled flaking and chipping, the Indians found it most suitable for arrow points, knives, spear points, and ceremonial blades. The tools used in obsidian working are simple. Several sizes of hammer stones to break spalls from the obsidian nodule and to rough out the blank. And the pointed end of a deer antler or fractured bone for chipping. There are three basic techniques of obsidian working in North America: direct percussion, indirect percussion, and pressure flaking or chipping. Among the California Indians, direct percussion was used for the rougher flaking. The pressure technique was then used for finishing the point. After a suitable flake of obsidian is removed from the nodule by a blow from the hammerstone, it is worked into final shape by chipping. Tiny chips are broken from the obsidian flake by pressing its edge at the proper point into the softer deer antler. The rough piece of obsidian was usually enfolded in a small flap of buckskin to protect the hand. By repeating this pressure around the edge of the blank, the shape of the projectile point gradually emerges. Since flint and obsidian points have been little used for a century or more, it is difficult to find someone skilled in this ancient craft. Only a few very old men remain who had occasion to learn flaking and chipping, and only a few inquisitive youths have sought out these older craftsmen for lessons in obsidian point making. One of these youths is Franklin Richards, a Tallawa Indian from Smith River, California. The various tribes had different customs connected with obsidian chipping. Certain Northern California tribes warmed obsidian before flaking, though it is not known why this was done. However, accounts of flaking by heating the obsidian and then dropping cold water on it have never been substantiated. The Pomo Indians of Clear Lake divided the local obsidian into two types. The first, which possessed superior flaking qualities, was used for arrow points. The second, which breaks cleanly with sharp edges, was used for knives and scrapers. In one California group, the pieces struck from a block of obsidian were carefully inspected by the point maker, who judged whether or not they possessed supernatural power and were poisonous. One chip he might consider poisonous, and the next from the same block, not poisonous. In some tribes, there were specialists who devoted most of their time to the production of finished stone implements, but these were usually individual artists and not an economic group or craft. The Pomo recognized shell bead makers and obsidian chippers as artisans and specialists. Working obsidian was hazardous because of the razor-sharp edges of the freshly chipped material. As a precaution, the Yahi painted their faces with mud to keep flying flakes out of their eyes and maintained silence, either for ceremonial purposes or to avoid getting pieces of flint or obsidian in their mouths. Although point making was tedious, a skilled worker could turn out a good arrow point in a relatively short time. 30 minutes or less was the average required. Few primitive peoples excelled the California Indians in stone flaking and chipping. So fragile are some of their tiny obsidian points, that it is hard to realize that they were actually employed as projectile tips. Yet numerous animal and human bones bear such delicately worked stones embedded in them. Knives of chert or obsidian were made in the same way as arrow points and were carried about as general utensils for scraping, skinning, and meat cutting. Although stone points were most commonly used on arrows, the Indians used other materials also. For shooting small game, such as birds and rabbits, blunt-tipped arrows were used. Some arrow shafts were fitted with points of one of the harder woods, further hardened by fire. The cross-stick point was used to increase effectiveness. If a bird was not killed outright by a direct hit, it would be stunned by the extension of the large blunt point. For killing elk, deer, bear, and predatory animals, sharp obsidian-pointed arrows were employed. Spear points were made in the same manner as arrow points, but were distinguished by their greater size. Archaeological evidence indicates that they predate arrow points in North America, being used as far back as 10,000 BC. Spears used ceremonially today retain the same form as the earlier obsidian-pointed spears which were used as weapons in prehistoric times. Ceremonial blades were also made from obsidian, and used in certain dances, particularly the white deerskin dance of northwestern California. Held aloft, a large blade was displayed as a sign of great wealth and prestige. Sometimes these blades were immense, measuring as much as 36 inches in length, though such large ones are modern and were rarely carried in dances. These blades were frequently wrapped with buckskin and had a loop that passed over the dancer's wrist as a safeguard against dropping. For a number of reasons, many ancient techniques of the American Aborigine have been lost to the modern-day Indians. However, bows, arrows, and their stone points are still made in the old tradition by a few artisans, even though the economic necessity for these artifacts has long passed.